Good morning to all of you all, and thank you very much for inviting me for this prestigious Dr. Shivanand oration. I mean, Dr. Shivanand is so humble that it's very difficult to find people who have reached to this stature and still remain very humble. So it's an honor to do this oration in his name. When I was asked to give this oration, the theme of the conference was more related to the trends that are occurring. So we thought it was very appropriate to have a talk on changing trends in diagnosis and management of pediatric infectious diseases. So I hope you enjoy a story that I'm going to tell you, starting from ancient times, going on to the present times, and probably what's going to happen in the future. Infectious diseases. Today we are in the seventh conference of this Karnataka State Infectious Disease Chapter Conference, and it's one of the leading causes of death in children, especially children less than 5 years. We talk about lifestyle diseases, diabetes and heart attack and all that, but we still are infectious disease number one. We have sepsis, which is killing us all. We have TB that's made a comeback. So we have a lot of infections that we have to deal with. And our chapter of infectious disease is still in the nascent phase. We're coming up. I think this is the fastest growing chapter in pediatrics today. And I think we need to work a lot hard to actually come to bring down the mortality in children. And this is what the top 10 leading causes of death. If you look at low-income countries, it's infections. If you looked at developed countries, it's more of heart disease, COPD, stroke. But infections do make a lot, big chunk in our country. Now if you look at infectious diseases, it's there right from the beginning. And if you're looking at proof, evidence-based, then we have these Egyptian mummies, which you go to Britain and you look into their museums and you'll find these mummies sitting there. And then they've done x-rays and they've done CT scans of these mummies, and they found smallpox in one of the pharaohs. We've had immense epidemics across the globe over the years, which have actually turned civilizations, been the downturn of the civilizations. We've heard about these epidemics of leprosy, plague, syphilis. I mean, these are the diseases we don't even see nowadays. Smallpox, cholera is still part in the northeastern part of our country. Yellow fever, typhoid fever, these were epidemics. And look at the kind of epidemics. This is a picture that I got about the plague in the Greek civilization that occurred in 430 BCE. This was actually the downfall of the Greek civilization. So what we had, one of the majestic civilizations, the Greeks, they lost it all due to plague. So this is how infectious disease has changed civilizations, changed history. It has been described in the books, the way it's been described, plague. I think the only time that we really, when I was an MBBS student and we heard about plague, was when there was an outbreak in Surat in Gujarat. And after that, this city has become one of the cleanest cities in the country. Plague is a disease of ancient times. Fever so intense that they preferred to be naked. Unceasing thirst, difficult to sleep, and they died within 7 to 9 days. If they survived the initial period, they would have disfiguration of their genitals, fingers, toes, blindness, and memory loss, that they did not even know who they were. This is the kind of disease that plague was. And how do we treat it now? Just one tetracycline, that's over, and plague is gone. Look at this, flu, Spanish flu in the early 1900s. We're talking about H1N1 today, but look at the kind of Spanish flu. Flu is not gone. It's always there, it comes in epidemics, but we've got drugs now to treat it. But this is the way they used to treat flu in the olden days. You know, everybody, we still have these kind of sanatoriums. I've been to a few Red Cross hospitals, and it's surprising to see that they still see cryptococcal meningitis with HIV, and they still have 100 patients with HIV admitted in these sanatoriums. Look at this H1N1, which really woke us up. 2009, started in Mexico, April 2009. By June, it had spread to 74 countries. So we've got air travel now, so we can spread epidemics faster. It's not going to get limited to one area. It's going to spread worldwide. And we are still dealing with H1N1. We now don't call it the novel H1N1. We all call it now as the epidemic, the regular endemic H1N1. WHO actually in 2007 stated that infectious diseases are spreading more rapidly than ever before, and that new infectious diseases are being discovered at a higher rate than any time in history. In the past 5 years, we've had 1,000 epidemics. Flu, swine flu. Right now, China has an epidemic of swine flu. We've had epidemics of polio and cholera. If you look at India, we talked about Greece and we talked about Spain. Let's talk about India. We've got Mohenjo-daro and Harappan civilization, one of the most advanced civilizations of their times. And when they have done the pathology of the specimens that they got, osteomyelitis, leprosy, TB was present even then. The concepts of infectious disease, that you get exposed, you may not get a disease, you may get an infection, but you may not get a disease, you may get a mild disease, you may get a severe disease, and probably death. This concept actually came much, much later. How did people actually deal with infectious disease even before the era where they knew that there were bacteria, viruses, or fungi? Look at 6th century BC. India is, it's in its golden period at that time. And we had these Ayurvedacharyas, whom we could call scientists of those times, who knew what they were doing. They were doing plastic surgeries. They were talking about treating infectious diseases. Shushrut himself said that kusht, jwar, and shosh, that's skin disease, fever, and TB, all are contagious and occur due to direct contact or by use of contaminated objects. He knew that 2,000 years ago. And this is the Sushruta Samhita, which is there in the Los Angeles Museum, which is from Nepal. So we've lost it, they've got it, they don't know how to read it. And we have people who know how to read it, but we can't access it. We have Charak Samhita. And he described the role of Vayu, Udak, Desh, and Kal, which are responsible for epidemics. So they knew this at that time. And how did they deal with it? So they said that there is management of krimi, which we tell them, you know, in Gujarati we tell them, do you have krimi in your stomach? That means do you have worms in your stomach? And so he talked about krimi at that time, and he said micro and microorganisms tend to produce disease. And how do you take care of them? Remove the krimi, which is in modern times what we call as panchkarma. So you do vaman, you do virechan, you do basti, shirovirechan, and you do raktamoksh. So you do emesis, purgation, enemas, you do niti, that's nasal drops, or you do bloodletting. That's exactly what we still do. I mean, if I have to do a colonoscopy today, I actually make them do, give them enemas and purgation to make the bowel absolutely clear. Prakriti vighat. So they say there are drugs that will inhibit the growth of these microbes. So they had those drugs. And we in India are losing patents of these drugs. Today, turmeric is the wonder drug. Curcumin is the way it's marketed. And it's being used for everything. And it's part of our normal spices that we eat, and we are losing patent about it. The most important antiseptic that we have in our country is neem. We are losing patent of neem. Today China is trying for that patent. So we have these drugs, we have these natural drugs which we need to tap and see what comes out of it. And then they have this Vidhan Parivarjan. So you prevent the disease completely. So they have ways of doing that so many thousands of years back. How did infectious disease change history? We know all about Alexander the Great. He came right till Takshila and went back. He died at Babylon of suspected typhoid. So if he had not died at this young an age, probably the world would be different today. Hippocrates, we all take the Hippocratic oath when we pass out of medical school. He wrote that the spread of disease was by air, water, or places, and he made an association between climate, diet, and living conditions. And then we had these places which were totally unexplored. We're talking about Americas, and we're talking about Australia. The Europeans explored these words, took with them a lot of rodents, vectors, lots of diseases, and spread them to the rest of the world. It said that syphilis spread to the Americas when Columbus went to America. It is said that syphilis came to India when the British came here. We didn't have syphilis here. So there are diseases that have now come to us because of these explorations. And we are in the news. We had this Andaman island last week. We had some Christian missionary who was killed by these tribes. These are the tribes which are untouched. Nobody is allowed to go to those islands. They don't want to make contact with humanity. There are some 50 to 150 of them staying. They've never been exposed to any diseases with the outside world. And the government is scared that if somebody goes and meets them, they're going to land with measles and influenza for which they have no immunity. So we have these kind of untouched areas still, which are free of many infectious diseases. Infectious diseases have also changed our genetic makeup. We talk about falciparum malaria, and we say sickle cell anemia. We know that sickle cell anemia is supposed to be protective, and you can see that the belt of falciparum is the same as the belt of sickle cell anemia. So it's actually led to changing in our genetic pattern as well. If we talk about modern medicine and the way we look at medicine today, then Fracastoro, he was the one who talked about germs in the year 1500 AD. He said that they spread through direct contact, fomites, and airborne. Nobody believed him at that time. Nobody accepted his theory at that time. In fact, he was the one who described syphilis for the first time. And he subsequently, it was identified that this was syphilis. What people used to accept as a theory is the Miasma theory, which they said was due to bad air. Cholera, chlamydia, black death was all due to bad air. And this was the theory that we used to look at till the 19th century. It's like Galileo, where he said that the earth moves around the sun, and nobody believed him at that time, and everybody said the sun moves around the earth. So it's similar to that. 1847, that was the first concept of antisepsis that came into the picture. He was a Hungarian obstetrician. He used to work at Vienna. He found there was a high maternal mortality following births which were assisted by doctors or medical students. But if the midwife was attending the delivery, then these mothers didn't get infection. He was wondering why this was happening. He realized most of the doctors were coming straight from the autopsies. So he made the doctors wash their hands with chlorinated lime before examining pregnant women. And the mortality fell from 18% to 2.2%. So that's the first concept of hand hygiene that actually came up. And this was in the year 1847. 1849, in the US, they established that cholera was spread by fecal-oral route, and they said that you need to boil the water and filter it before you use it. I will give you an example. I went to Mani Mahesh last year, and usually when you go to these pilgrimage places, you actually take the water from there as a sacred water and keep it with you. The Ganga water that I had taken in 2004 from Haridwar has remained the same. But the Mani Mahesh water, which I took last year, has turned black. Mani Mahesh is at a height of 14,000 meters. The amount of human garbage that's there, it's phenomenal. The amount of human excreta that you see there, it's phenomenal. It's there in there, the kund that they talk about, it's there in the lake. Can you imagine? These are glacial waters, and they are becoming rotten now. We used to drink these waters uncooked, unfiltered, unboiled. And I think we need to do something about these Himalayan waters, otherwise we are going to lose a lot of it to infectious diseases. Louis Pasteur was the one who came out with the principle of pasteurization. And this slide on the picture on the right shows that if you open up the flask and let it get exposed to air after boiling, you will still get the germs. But if you don't open up the glass after boiling, it will remain sterile. So he was the one who discovered Vibrio and suggested boric acid to kill these microorganisms and the possibility of pasteurization. And that's how we started doing milk pasteurization. Lister was the one who looked at antisepsis surgically, and he talked about carbolic acid and phenol as an antiseptic. So we had a lot of these industrial revolutions that took place in the 19th century, and we all know about Koch's postulates, Robert Koch, the one who discovered the tuberculosis bacilli. What were his four postulates? He said the microorganism must be found in abundance in all organisms suffering from the disease, but should not be found in healthy organisms. So you have these two rats, in one in which the black rods are there, which is the germ causing, and that's why it's caused the disease. The second postulate that he put forward was the microorganism must be isolated from a diseased organism and growth in pure culture, which we still go by today. We want a culture positive before we say it's the germ. The culture microorganism should cause disease when introduced into a healthy organism. And the microorganism must be re-isolated from the inoculated diseased experimental host and identified as being identical to the original specific causative agent. So he's the one who put forward these theories, and we are actually following these even today, except for the first one, which he abandoned because he realized that we could be asymptomatic carriers of organisms like cholera and typhoid, which we know now. How did this all become possible? It was with the invention of the microscope. First century AD, glass was discovered. 1590s, two optometrists actually made a telescope kind of a thing. So they put two glasses into a rod, and they found they could magnify things. It was Anthony Leeuwenhoek in 1670 who actually magnified it to 270 times and discovered bacteria. He's called the father of bacteriology. And the viruses were actually discovered in 1890s. So we actually look at infectious diseases from our microscope discovery. Following that, we had emerging treatment strategies. So we looked at the diagnosis, we came up to the microscope. And then we had treatment strategies where we had these drugs, monoclonal antibodies, antibiotics. We looked at cytokines, we looked at cellular therapies, a lot of new innovations in emerged infectious disease. How was infectious disease treated earlier? 1630, for malaria, they used to import from Brazil, the Peru, quinine. That's when quinine was discovered. Antibodies were discovered when they used to inject the serum of animals against Clostridium tetani and diphtheria. So we still use antidiphtheric serum, but we don't use the equine one now, so we have a recombinant one. But these were all obviously abandoned after discovery of antibiotics. So we hardly use antibodies nowadays, except for probably one which we use is IVIG and monoclonal antibodies. So pembrolizumab is an antibody that we use for the prevention and treatment of respiratory syncytial virus. The advantage of these antibody discovery was we started using ELISAs. And ELISAs really helped us to make a diagnosis of infectious diseases. We use ELISAs now left, right, and center for our diagnosis of infectious diseases. When did the antibiotics came? It was Fleming who actually discovered it by mistake. He had left the fungi open, and he found the fungi was secreting some drug, some substance, which was inhibiting the growth of the bacteria in that tube. And that's when he realized it's penicillin. And he received a Nobel Prize for it, actually. Penicillin was used left, right, and center in World War II, and it's supposed to have saved a lot of lives, thousands of lives. Penicillin, unfortunately, we're hardly using nowadays. It's still a very wonderful drug. Most of the companies have actually stopped manufacturing penicillin because we doctors don't use it. But it's one of the most wonderful drugs for tonsillitis, syphilis. So these are the drugs which we still need to work. At that time, Fleming had made a good observation. He said it is not difficult to make microbes resistant to penicillin in the laboratory by exposing them to concentrations not sufficient to kill them. And the same thing can occur in the human body. I mean, in 1945, he already predicted drug resistance. Subsequently, a lot of antibiotics were discovered, and we have these antibiotics, the last one coming up in 2000. That's where we stopped. We don't have anything after that. We've got no new antibiotics. We are just juggling with cephalosporins, carbapenems, using some tazobactam, clavulanic acid to make a combination, and we're just juggling with our antibiotics. Resistance started almost from 1947. And by the year, in the 2000s, we are actually having MRSAs, we're having vancomycin resistance, enterococci, we're talking about ESBL. So we have a lot of resistance that has now come up. If you look at the kind of resistance, a new drug comes, in the next 1 to 4 years, you'll face resistance. That's how we're using them. And I think India is using the highest user of antibiotics in the world currently. Look at this timeline of antibiotic resistance. The top ones are the times when these drugs were introduced, and the below ones are the ones when they became resistant. Look at the last one, dactomycin, somewhere around between 2000 to 2005, and it's already resistant. So we're talking about a time gap of 3 to 4 years, and we're getting resistance. So infectious disease, a lot of it, we are actually creating it. What about immunization? This is one aspect which the adults cannot compete with us, is vaccination and prevention. There is a history to that too. Buddhist monks used to drink snake venom to confer immunity to snake bite. Variolation, which was practiced earlier, they used to tear the skin and put in cowpox in that to gain immunity against smallpox. This is 17th century China. So we already have practices of immunization going on. Smallpox came up in, this vaccine came up in 1798. And by 1979, we eradicated smallpox. It's only there in the laboratories now. Other vaccines, cholera, anthrax, early 90s, plague, late 19th century. BCG vaccine, can you imagine we're still using a BCG vaccine which is 70 years old? 1923, we actually found a way to inactivate tetanus toxin, and that's what's being used for all your conjugated vaccines now. Whole cell pertussis vaccine came up in 1948. So we're using these vaccines which are pretty old, 60 to 70 years. We're still using polio, the Salk and the Sabin. We don't call it Salk and Sabin any longer. We call it the oral and the injectable polio. And we're using this for mass immunization to eradicate polio from the world. Measles vaccine, we're not talking about measles eradication and the MR campaign that's going on currently. And if you look at the vaccines, right from 1798, smallpox, to the last one, 1998, rotavirus, we've got N number of vaccines. And we've actually not had epidemics of smallpox or typhoid, cholera now, which used to occur in the olden days. If you look at mortality, 20th century starting, this was the mortality of most of the vaccines, and it's become zero in, this is about US data. So smallpox was 100% effective, diphtheria was 100% effective, polio, measles 100% effective. Most of the other vaccines, almost 95 to 99%. So we're talking about prevention. So we've come a long way. We've come a long way to eradicate the diseases that are killing mankind. Now we're talking about molecular genetics, and we're talking about recombinant vaccine, and we're talking about acellular pertussis vaccine, and we're talking about seasonal influenza vaccine. So we are producing an influenza vaccine before the season starts, predicting what's going to be the trend. So we've come that way now. And from a simple microscope, we've come to revolutionary molecular technologies. And what are these molecular technologies? DNA was first described by Watson and Crick in 1953, and they won a Nobel Prize for this. Subsequently, people started working on how to develop PCR and amplification of the DNA. And the PCR technique was was standardized by 1980s. So we now started talking about microscopy, ELISAs, and we started coming to PCRs. And now, currently, we're talking about syndromic testing of infectious disease. So we are not talking about a single organism and we are sending a test for say just H1N1, or we are not talking about only one sepsis and just sending a culture. We are talking about syndromic testing. And we have these multiplex PCRs which give us the whole gamut of infections in one swab. And we're talking about 20 minutes turnover time. So we're talking about meningitis, encephalitis panel, 14 organisms result in 20 minutes. So we now have evidence of what we're treating, and it changes our way of management. You picked up Streptococcus pneumoniae, you'll probably give antibiotics for 10 days. But if you picked up a meningococcal, you give for 5 days. It changes your management. Respiratory panel, we've got 20 organisms now, and we have now a new pneumonia panel, which was approved by the US FDA last week, in which you have 32 organisms. Can you imagine this in the ICU setup, which is also going to look at the genetic test, which will tell you whether this is ESBL, is it a carbapenemase, is it a MEXC gene? So it's going to tell you all that. It's going to change the way you treat infectious diseases. Look at the GI panel. I find this very useful, especially in chronic pneumonia, chronic diarrheas. And we picked up something like giardiasis, amoebiasis, where you would be just not getting it on a stool culture or a stool routine. And these have been helpful in chemotherapy patients, immunocompromised patients. So these are the ones that are now changing the way to treat infectious diseases. You have a sepsis panel. You can actually pick up which infection is there in the next 1 hour, change your antibody. The problem with the sepsis panel is that you need to have a blood culture growing something. So it's just going to make your time shorter towards treatment of an infectious disease, but it's not going to make you wiser, because in 24 hours you get what is the organism on your culture. But these are things that are now there, and we're changing the way we think and the way we treat. 1990 to 2003, the Human Genome Project was completed in 2003. We could sequence 10 million locations where single base DNA polymorphisms, that we call as SNPs, occur. And SNPs directly affect a person's susceptibility to infections. So today, if all of us in this room are exposed to pneumococcal, how many of us will actually get an infection is something that these SNPs can prevent. So not everybody is going to land with an infection. And this is some sort of a chart which the SNPs comes out. This is about malaria haplotypes. Very difficult to understand how these charts behave, but they actually tell you which one is prone to get malaria and which one is not. So SNPs are like your Jalan Kundalis. Okay, when you're born and the astrologer comes and tells your parents, look, his life is going to be like this, and his life is going to face these problems in the future. And if you take care of doing some yajna or some puja, you will take care of the 13th house and the 11th house. So your SNPs are like that. You take a drop of blood, you can predict whether he's going to get cancer in the future, whether he's going to get these infections in the future, if he's exposed to that environment, and what you can do. So medical science is actually predicting now whether we will get a particular disease or not. SNPs are still something which is more research-based. It's not going to come out very soon into the market, because we're talking about millions of dollars to test one patient. So it's not that easy to get it back into the market. But this is something which is really exciting, where you can actually predict. We talked about infections that we've eradicated. We talked about smallpox, we talked about polio. But there is always an emerging infection. And the most important example is HIV. HIV actually was there in the 1920s in Congo. And it's supposed to have spread from chimpanzees to humans. Then air travel was not that fast, so sporadic cases till 1970. But then there was a burst, especially among gay men. And in the 1980s, it spread to 5 continents, and around 100 to 3,000 people have been affected. This is the kind of HIV we used to see in the 1990s when we had our HIV living. We now don't see HIV like this. We now see HIV patients on treatment doing well. And then we have a lot of research coming out. I think HIV was one of the most researched infectious diseases ever. So we have drugs coming out for this very, very soon. And we have drugs coming out for the reverse transcriptase inhibitors, fusion inhibitors, protease inhibitors, integrase inhibitors. So we had a lot of these drugs. These are just the three groups that I've shown you. We started with drugs which we use, And the red ones, we've already stopped using them. So we're going very fast in treatment of HIV. HIV treatment also taught about evidence-based medicine. Zidovudin was the first drug that came. We started using it as monotherapy. Virus would go down, come back again. Then people started using dual therapy. Virus would go down, stay down for a little while, come back again. And then we had this triple therapy where the virus would go down and remain down. And that's how we came to an era of triple therapy, evidence-based. We're still talking about emerging infections. We're talking about Zika virus now. It's there in Gujarat, it's there in Rajasthan, it's there in Madhya Pradesh. Ebola virus, chikungunya virus, MERS virus. We're talking about a resurgence of dengue, malaria, and TB. So we have these infections. So even though we eradicated a few, we've got more in our basket now to deal with. And how can we talk about infectious disease without the immune system? The understanding of the immune system, the innate, the specific immunity, talking about congenital immunodeficiencies, changed the way that we treat infectious diseases. We started talking about options of bone marrow transplant. We talked about interferon gamma and CGD. We talked about longer duration of AKT in patients with MSMD. We started talking about prophylaxis with cotrimoxazole, itraconazole. We talked about monthly IVIG injections in sclerohypogammaglobulinemia. And HLH, something that we keep on hearing left, right, and center, and change the way that we treat an EBV-associated HLH. We actually give them immunosuppression. So infectious disease is not only about antibiotics, antivirals, antifungals. It's a lot more than that. And then we talked about ideal special situations, organ transplants, hospital-acquired infections, and we also talked about zoonotic infections. We're traveling a lot. We like to go for vacations. Indians are the biggest travelers in the world after Japan and China. And we like to go to exotic places, and we touch animals, and we play with animals, and we don't know what we land up with. So zoonosis is something that's an upcoming problem. And then now we talk about PKPD data. So we talk about clinical pharmacology in infectious diseases. We talk about the way we treat. We used to use iron at 5 milligram per kg. We got PKPD data. We started using iron at 10 milligram per kg. So we are looking at all these. We're talking about whole genome sequencing now. So we're talking about the way we treat diseases. TB, when you talk, they talk about cultures, DSD. They say, wait, we want to give you whole genome sequencing. What are you talking about DSDs now? Evidence-based, pneumonias, we used to treat for 14 days IV. Now we treat pneumonias, OPD basis. Osteomyelitis, we used to treat it for 6 weeks IV. Now we give 3 to 4 weeks, 3 to 4 days of IV and then just send them home and give them oral antibiotics, probably not even 6 weeks, total 3 weeks. We got evidence for it. So we are now talking about randomized controlled trials. We've really taken a leap towards prevention. Measles, HIP, pneumococci, meningococci, rotavirus, varicella. Hepatitis B, I remember when it came, it was 1,500 rupees. And now the vaccine is available for 50 rupees. So we've gone a long way with that. Dengue virus, unfortunately, this vaccine is not in India currently. It's a wonderful vaccine. I mean, it's really working in children more than 9 years of age. Prevention. Why only vaccines? We've come down on HIV. HIV epidemic has died down. 35% prevalence transmission from mother to child. We're talking about no child now with HIV. We're talking about mass immunization, polio, MR. And now we're talking also about emergence of multi-resistant pathogens. So we're talking about, and everybody talks about the New Delhi bug. Everybody talks about medical tourism. And this person went to India, went in the ICU and came back with this infection. We're talking about NDR, MXDR, TB. We're talking about ESBLs and PAN resistance. And I think we really need to work on antibiotics here. We're talking about, we don't have any new drug. So we come up with the old drugs and use them off-label. We talk about colistin, we talk about digacycline in neonates, we talk about chloramphenicol, we talk about phosphomycin, itraconazole, posaconazole, which we actually don't use in children, we started using them. So where are we headed in infectious diseases? Excellent diagnostics. We are running out of antibiotics. We have pan-resistant infections coming up. We have emerging infections. We have old infections re-emerging. And old infections being replaced by new ones. We thought polio is out, but acute flaccid paralysis is not out. It's been replaced by enterovirus. And the US FDA has actually declared that they had 124 cases of AFP in their country and they think it's probably enterovirus. We don't have that kind of a surveillance system here. Infectious disease has been there with mankind right from time immemorial. But fellowships, they've just started recently. I think in the US it started in 1960s, these fellowships. In Mumbai, in India, we've started probably 3 or 4 years back. And earlier these fellowships were more with the microbiologists or people who were doing travel medicine or tropical medicine. Now it's an upcoming specialized branch. This is Wadia Hospital where I practice. It's one of the oldest hospitals in Mumbai, Children's Hospital. So that's a very old photograph taken from the terrace of Kalyan Hospital. It's almost 80 years now. And we started the branch of infectious diseases. 1998, we started the pediatric HIV and perinatal HIV clinic. We treated more than 1,600 mother infants as part of prevention. And we could say right from the beginning, our transmission rate was 5%, which went down to less than 2%. We always used to advocate actually cesarean section at that time before we had these newer drugs that came out. And now we've actually started doing vaginal delivery. 2007 was the first time we started seeing drug-resistant TB. That's when we established the pediatric TB clinic. And I remember I used to see 60 patients of HIV and probably 10 patients of TB in those days. Now it's changed. I need to have a TB clinic twice a day, twice a week. So I have 70 patients every OPD that come. We've actually started a specialized DRTB clinic because we have a resistance pattern of almost 10% of TB of patients have DRTB. We started an IT clinic in 2007. 2018, there was a big problem of pan-resistant infections and we had to start the antibiotic stewardship program. So that's how we started. And every specialty I think needs a lab backup. So you need to be involved as a clinician with the lab. You can't depend only on the microbiologist to set up a lab or your technicians to run the lab. You need to be involved into the lab. So that's how we've gone. We're still in our nascent phase of infectious disease, not to the standards that international standards would have, but it's a beginning. And that's our team. And thank you very much for this.